So let me just quickly tell you what exactly we have done till now and what are we going to do today. So we understood, just ignore this as of now, we will come to this later. So we understood that when we are talking about financial supply chain management, it is all about making sure that you have enough cash available to make sure that you are not able to, sorry, you are able to pay to your vendors on time, and you are also not having more cash than it is required so that you can invest and get more out of the market, right? So very important thing that we discussed in FSCM is making sure that you are able to collect the money from your customer on time. Okay, so one of the important thing to make sure that you always receive money on time is you need to evaluate your customers based on their credit history. Okay, so at any point of time, you don't want any customer to get the material from you and then you are chasing him a lot, but he's not paying. So that will definitely impact your financial supply chain, right? So in order to make sure that there is enough money available and your customers are paying on time, it is also important to evaluate each and every customer and give that much credit, that much you can afford, right? Rather than giving a lot of credit and then chasing the customers to pay that particular amount. So we understood the credit management. We understood how can we use SAP FSCM component to perform the credit management. How can we evaluate each and every customer? How can we provide the different ratings to each and every customers? How can we provide the different risk categories to each and every customers, limits to the customers, and make sure that whenever a order is received from the customer based on his credit status at any point of time, whether that order should be accepted or not. All right, so those things we have discussed, and now let's assume the second part. So already we given the credit to the customer, right? Based on the credit settings, whatever we have done, based on whatever categories we provided, based on whatever sales order checks were performed, ultimately we were able to give this material to the customer. Okay, so now customer is already like we already provided the material to the customer. Now it is our turn to receive the payment from the customer. All right, so again, some of the customers are good customers. They will pay you on time before the due date. But there are some other customers for which you need to remind them. Okay, so it may happen that the due date of the customer was on 10th, but today is, let's say, 17th. So already 7 days gone by, but this customer has not paid. Right? Let's take a simple example. Let's take a simple example of your, let's say, the mobile. If you are using the postpaid mobile or if you are using the broadband connection and you got a due date from that vendor and you are not paying, so what happens? The collection team, there is a collection team. So for this service providers, they have their own collection team. They will start calling you and remind you that your amount is due. Okay, we can see that there is some amount due, overdue. Instead of due, it is overdue on your particular account, and please make sure that you pay that amount at earliest. Why they do that? They do it because they want to make sure that their financial supply chain is up to the date, right? So it should not happen that customers are not paying on time and then the business is getting impacted because of that. So one of the very important activity in any company is make sure that you are able to collect the amount on time from the customers. So if the customers are not paying on time, it is your responsibility, your company's responsibility to remind them, and that is the reason there is a need of the collection department, right? So this is the purpose of collection. The purpose of the collection department is, first of all, go into the system, collect the list of those invoices which are due, but customer has not paid till now, right? And then based on the type of the customer, see, there can be some customers who are good customers. Maybe this time they are not paid, so you can give some additional days without reminding them. There can be some other customers who are very, like they are at very high risk. Even after the high risk, you provided the material, but now they are not paying. So you want to make sure that they are at high priority when it comes to the collections, right? So One of the important activity of any company is make sure that the collections from the customers are on time. So that is exactly what we are going to discuss today, how SAP can help you in making sure that your collections department is able to mark each and everything in the system. Okay, so first of all, let's assume there is a collection department in your company, right? This collection department is responsible to make sure that the amount from the customers is received on time. So the first thing that they want to see from the system is they want to see the list of overdue items. Okay, so they will see the list of overdue items. Now, based on this overdue items, they want to make sure that the customers who are at high risk are on high priority. So the first call or the first mail or whatever way you want to communicate with the customer, the first priority should be given to those customers who are at very high risk, right? Similarly, from high priority to low priority, you need to remind each and every customer that there is this amount which is pending, please make the payment. If not, then maybe there can be various different scenarios in which customer can say, give me some time, or maybe I'm not paying because the material was faulty. There can be, just assume you are a collection person, you are a employee in a collections department, and your customer has not paid on time. Now, if you try calling them, they will give you various different reasons. Okay, some of the customers will say, no problem, I forgot that this amount was due, I will make sure that it is paid in 1 or 2 days. There will be some other customers, they will say, it was purposefully, I have not paid purposefully because the quality of the material that you provided is not good, right? So that is kind of a dispute case. You have to create a dispute case in that case, right? Some other customers will tell you, okay, I know there is an amount which was pending, but the problem is I have a limited cash now, so maybe I'll be paying next week, for example. So this is called as promise to pay. So customer is promising you that he will be paying in maybe in next week. So all these things, we need to see how exactly this entire process works in SAP S/4HANA. So any question on the understanding of what is collections? When we are talking about collections, what exactly we mean by the collections management? Any question? Not yet. No. So let's continue then. Okay. So let's assume.
Hello, sir. I'm Kit this side. I have one question regarding one scenario. For example, we have created the sales order of 100 USD, but after some time we come to that conclusion that it is our fault. The sales order actual value of sales order should be 110 or 120 USD. So in that case, this is a scenario of collection or dispute, because it is a fault at our end.
No, see, if you already, there are two things. Number one is, if you already realized your mistake even before customer has complained, then it is not a dispute. It is your mistake, so you will be rectifying it. So either you will be sending him another invoice, or you will be completely canceling the, or maybe you will be rectifying that same invoice. So if you identified the problem, then it is not a dispute. Dispute is when customer has raised, and now you need to check internally whether what customer is saying is correct or he's just trying to not pay the amount, right? So dispute is when you are not sure whether the problem is from our side or not, but customer is saying the problem is from our side. This is a dispute case. If you realized on your own without customer has told you anything, then it is not a dispute. Okay, so let's take an example. Who is creating the dispute case? Collections department. Now, collections department is not knowing which material you provided to the customer. Maybe at the looking at the invoice, he'll be able to know this material you provided, but he will not be able to know whether the material was of good quality, the rate which you provided is correct or not. So collections department has nothing to do with what quantity we provided, what value we provided, and what quality we provided, right? So if the customer is telling directly to the collections department, at that time, collections department doesn't know. That is the reason it is a dispute, right? But if your team already knows that, yes, this is a proper comment what customer is making, in that case, it is not a dispute. I hope you got the difference between the dispute and the error that you made on your own. Okay, Ankit,
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'll take one example now. Let's say there is a customer. Okay, so customer has placed the sales order. The sales order was, or maybe I will just try to show you this complete in the graphical way. So let's see the entire process. So first of all, the sales order was created, right? Now, obviously at the time of sales order, if the credit management is active, credit check was performed. Once this sales order is created, what will happen next? Based on the sales order delivery date, you will be delivering this material to your customer, right? So after the sales order has been created, material has been delivered. So delivery document was created. Okay, and after this delivery, you send the invoice to the customer. Right, so next step is you have created the invoice. Now in this invoice, there was a due date. Let's say the due date was 20th of May. Okay, 20th of May was the due date of this particular invoice. Now let's assume today we are already on 31st of May or 30th of May. Already 10 days overdue. This invoice is already overdue by 10 days. The due date was 20th and customer has not paid even till the 30th of May. Now, from the financial point of view, there may be some dunning notices also sent to this customer, right? So normally what we do from finance, in order to remind the customer for making the payment, we send him the dunning letters. But dunning letters are kind of the word documents which are sent or mailed to the customer just to remind him. Okay, but in addition to that, if you have a separate collections department which is actually making the calls to the customer, there may be another 100 types of ways in which you can remind the customer and ask him, when are you going to pay? So let's assume there is already one dunning notice which is already created for this customer, but still customer is not paying. Right, so what you will do, you will wait for maybe 7 days, 8 days, 10 days. And after 10 days, let's say your company has a policy. Once 10 days are over, so you are giving 10 days, let's say as a tolerance day before you make any collections call to the customer. So till 30th of May, this invoice will remain with finance. Okay, they will not pass this invoice to the collections department. They will wait for 10 days. They will send the dunning letters. They will wait if the customer is paying or not. Even after 10 days, if this customer is not paying, then this finance department will transfer to the collections department. They will go to the collections department and they will say, please try to collect this material from this customer. So this will come to the collections department. Now, once it came to the collection department, the real process starts of the collections management, right? So now let me tell you what exactly collection department will do. First of all, once you transfer the data from FI, there is a program. Okay, in SAP, there is a program which transfers the data of the overdue line items to the collections department based on the proper strategy. We will talk about what is that strategy. So in some of the cases, the strategy is that the documents will be sent after 10 days. Okay, in this case, the document is overdue by 10 days. But there can be another strategy that for this particular customer, the documents will be only sent after 30 days. Right, so based on the strategy, whatever is the strategy, the documents will flow from FI to the collections department. Now, once this collection departments get the list of all these documents which are open, this is called as the work list. So collection department will get the work list. Okay, what is the work list now? Work list is a list of all those customers or all those customers overdue and for which you need to call to the customers to make the collections, right? So once the work list has been created, now let's assume, I will just try to create a small table here. Sorry. Okay, let's assume this is a work list which is created. So this is a customer number. Okay, this is second thing is priority. Whether it is high priority, we need to, if it is high priority, then definitely we need to call this customer first. Okay, total amount due. Okay, let's say these are the three columns. There are a lot of other things. I'm just trying to show you one example. So I'm removing these two columns as of now, which we don't need. Okay, and let me move this to this side so that our this can continue. So customer number, let's say one, customer number two, customer number three. Okay, priority, this customer is very high priority. Okay, this customer is, let's say, low priority, and last one also is low priority. Okay, and whatever is the amount, total amount pending. Okay, so I just entered some amount. So let's say this collection department has got this list. In that list, it is very clearly mentioned which customer, how much amount, and what is a priority to collect this amount from the customers. Now, what exactly this collection department will do? Based on the priority, he will try to contact to the customer. Okay, maybe by call, maybe by email, maybe by correspondence, whatever way is possible. Right, so he will, let's say he is calling to this customer and he's telling the customer, sir, I can see that there is a total amount due of 1000. The due date was on 20th of May, so it is already 10 days overdue item. When can we expect this payment? Right, and customer is saying, oh, I forgot to make this payment. Maybe just give me 1 or 2 days. I will try to make the payment. Okay, so you will say, okay, so shall I consider that you are going to make the payment on, let's say, on the 3rd of June, by 3rd of June? He will say yes, 100%. So in that case, what you will do is, this is called as promise to pay. So there can be one example where your customer is saying that I will pay on this particular date. So he is giving you the promise that he'll be paying on this particular date. So this is one scenario where customer is promising you to pay. So this is called as promise to pay. Okay, again, let's assume, or let's go to the second customer now. You call to the second customer, you told this customer there is this amount which is pending and the due date was on 20th of May, but you are still not paid. And he's saying, yes, I know there was a due date on 20th of May. And the reason why I not paid is maybe the quality of the material that you have provided is not good, or maybe the amount that you charged is more than what we agreed. So whatever, it can be the price disagreement, it can be the quality disagreement, it can be the terms disagreement, whatever it is. In short, it is dispute. Why it is a dispute? Because this is who is contacting the customer, not the salesperson who sold the material to the customer. Collection department is contacting this customer, and collection department doesn't have this idea. What was the rate agreed? What was the quality agreed? Which material was delivered? Right. So for collection department, they don't have any idea. And that is the reason they have to create this as a dispute case. So in this case, if a customer says that there was some problem with the material, or there is some problem with the terms, or maybe the price, in that case, you may need to create the dispute case. Okay, let's go to the third scenario. In the third scenario, you contacted to the customer. You said, okay, this much amount is pending, the due date was this, and we are still not received the payment. Okay, oh, sorry, let's take another scenario. You contacted this customer, but the customer is not picking the phone. Right, so in that case, what will happen? You are not able to contact that customer. Right, so that is also something which you need to enter here. Otherwise, if your manager will ask, I given you the list of customers, what is the status? So you should know the status. You will open the first line item and you will show your manager that, oh, this customer has promised to pay on this particular date. All these things you are capturing in the system. Okay, we call to the customer number two and he said there is a dispute case. So I already raised the dispute case. Let's the sales team check it. And if there is any concern, we will treat this particular invoice accordingly. Okay, and the third case, I contacted this customer, but he's not reverting my call. right? So in this case, there is no contact possible. Customer not reachable. Just in short, it is saying customer is not reachable. Okay, and there can be some other scenarios also in which you are resubmitting. I'll tell you what is resubmitting. Resubmitting means it can be because of customer is not reachable itself, but you want to call this customer tomorrow. Okay, so you will say this is rescheduling kind of thing, resubmission actually. Resubmission means you want to tell the system that I was not able to call this customer tomorrow, but let me remind, please remind me that tomorrow I need to call this particular customer. So that is called as resubmission. Okay, we will talk about all these things. I just want to make sure that you understand from the process point of view before I go into the SAP. So any question till now? Have you understood what exactly is promise to pay? What exactly is a dispute case? How the values will flow from the FI to the collections department?
Vikram, I just have one question.
Yeah.
Initially, you had mentioned about the dunning, right?
Mm-hmm.
So after every time should we do the dunning, or dunning will be only for the overdue items?
No, dunning is up to you. There is no link between, see, definitely we will be using dunning in integration with collections management, but for collections management, it is not necessary that you have to dun or you don't need to dun. But again, if you are asking the simple question related to dunning, so dunning is normally done for the overdue items only.
Okay.
Okay, so only difference between collections and dunning is dunning can be triggered from FI. As far as SAP is concerned, dunning letters you can simply create from the finance module itself. But when it comes to the collections, collections is treated in FSCM.
Okay. So only if it is overdue, then it becomes a promise to pay, correct? If my understanding is correct.
No. Promise to pay is when customer has promised you to pay. It is not necessary that if the item is overdue, automatically it will go to promise to pay. Promise to pay means when you are seeing that this item is overdue, you contacted customer and customer said, I will pay you on this particular date. So that is promise to pay.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Right. Thanks.
Okay. Now let's try to create one scenario in our SAP system, in our own company code that we are using throughout this course. Let me log into SAP. Okay, and definitely before we see the business process, we have to do some basic configurations, right? So I will do some basic configurations, then I will show you the entire process, and then we will revisit the configurations again, so that we can just try to change some things and we'll see the impact in the process. Okay, so let's go to IMG. So for all the collections management related configurations, obviously you go to financial supply chain management, and within financial supply chain management, you'll be able to see this collections management module. Okay, let's open this collections management. Okay, similar to credit management, in credit management also we have seen basically there are two different subfolders. One is basic settings and second is integration with AR. Here there was integration with SD. So one is basic setting, which is applicable for collections management only, and second is how the values will flow from AR. See, all these values, where exactly you will be able to see which invoices are due? They are not coming to collections directly. They have to come from AR only. In accounts receivables, you create the invoices. In accounts receivable, you create the billing documents, right? So all those billing documents, all those invoices will get transferred from FI AR component to collections management. And that is the reason there is a need to integrate these two components. Okay, they are very tightly integrated with each other. So first I will go to the basic settings. Let's go to the basic settings. And number one itself, let's start with the basic data. In basic data, First of all, you have to define the company codes for SAP collections management. So whatever company codes you are going to use for collections management, in our case, FSCM. So if I go here, see currently FSCM is not included here. If our FSCM is not included here, then definitely we will not be able to process the collections management in this company code. So the first thing that we need to do is click on the new entry and specify for which company code you want to activate collections management. Okay, so in our case, our company code is FSCM and try to save this. Okay, this is the first step. Without this, you will not be able to use collections management for your company code. Okay, let's close this. We will revisit whatever are the other settings which are not required. I am not touching it as of now. Whatever are the mandatory settings, I'm just updating that. Okay, second one, I'll go for the collection strategies. Okay, so what I'll do here is in collection strategies, I will show you the standard strategy first. Okay, let's go to the process strategies. And I'm just removing this from here and click on start. It will show you whatever strategies are available. So you can see there are one or two standard strategies which are pre-delivered by SAP. So you can see sample one, sample two, sample three. Okay, let's try to double click on this. See, this is a strategy name. And in this strategy, you can see these are the different conditions. Okay, so just try to understand what is happening here. I want, as I told you, what we want is we want to transfer the data from FI, AR to the collections department. Now the question is which invoices you want to transfer? I given you the example. Sometimes in your company, they will say only after 10 days. If you go to some other company, they will say no. The AR invoices, if they are overdue by 30 days, then only transfer. Even there can be maximum amount also. Let's say there is an invoice of $100. Do you want to unnecessarily transfer it to the collections department? Our collection department is going to call to the customer just because of $100. Again, it depends upon company to company. Some of the companies will say yes, whatever is the amount. If amount is due, overdue, we want to call to the customer. So the question is, which invoices will flow from here to collections department? So that exactly is called as a collection strategy. Collection strategy means what information you want to pass out from here to the collections department. So that you have to create in the collection strategy based on your requirements. In this particular case, you can see there are a lot of conditions. Okay, what are the conditions? You can see first one is successful customer contact in last 2 days without contact type. Okay, forget about this. Let's try to keep it simple. I'll show you one or two conditions, or maybe let's go with this one, which I created just to keep it simple. So in this case, what I have done is I told the system that transfer the values from FI component to collections component only when this condition is true. What is this condition? Let's try to click on this and click on the conditions. So I told the system that if the amount is between 1 to whatever is this amount, maximum amount, and if the invoice is overdue by 7 days. So in short, whatever is the amount, I'm not worried about amount. Amount can be anything, even if it is $1. If it is overdue by 7 days, so all those invoices which are overdue by 7 days, I want to transfer from FI to collections component. Right? So this is, I'm just using one condition. You can use multiple conditions based on your customer's requirement. Right? So in this case, I will show you one example with the same strategy, and then we will come and we will try to configure the strategy as per our requirements. Right? Let's go back. Let's close this also. Okay, and then coming to the organization structure. So this one I will try to explain you in the reverse direction. If you remember, if I want to use credit management, what I need to do at the business partner level? If I want to use credit management, I need to do something at the business partner level, right? What normally I do, I extend a new business partner role. What is that role?
credit management role.
UKM 000.
UKM 000, right? UKM 000 is a role which is related to the SAP credit management. Similarly, if I want to use the collections management for a particular customer, okay, if you want to use collections management for a particular customer, again, you have to go for another role, which is UDM 000. UDM 000, this is a role for collections management. Okay. And similar to credit management, in credit management, when we tick on this, it allows you two additional tabs here and one tab here, right? Let me show you. So if I click on credit management, you can see credit profile, credit worthiness data, and credit segment data. These are the three tabs which will open as soon as I select the credit management role. Similarly, in case of UDM 000, what will happen is there is only one new tab will come here, collection profile, single tab. Okay, and if you click on this collection profile, this is where you will be able to enter the collection profile. Okay, what is collection profile now? Obviously, we have to create this collection profile. I'll show you how. Once you assign the collection profile to your business partner, okay, system will automatically determine the collection segment similar to credit segment. So the collection segment is SFIN, and there is a collection group. What is collection group now? So let's say in my collections team, there is a separate collection team and there are 15 different employees who are working in the collections team. Okay, and I want to group them into different groups. Let's say I created three groups. So collection group one, collection group two, and collection group three. Collection group one will be responsible only for international customers. They will only remind the international customers to make the payment. Just for example, collection group two is responsible for all the domestic payments, and collection group three is only responsible for intercompany vendors or intercompany customers. Just take an example, don't take it very seriously. It can be any category. So ultimately, your collections team, okay, whatever is the size of your collection team, you are dividing them into the groups. That is called as a collection group. So at the customer level, you can tell the system which collection team is responsible or which collection group is responsible to do the collection management for this particular customer. Okay, so these three things, collection profile, collection segment, and collection group, this is exactly what you are defining in the enterprise structure of collections management. So within collections management, you need to define the collection segment, collection profile, and collection group. And all these three things are assigned to the business partner. Okay, let's first go with the collection segment. Okay, this is where you will be creating the collection segment. So I'll click on new entries. Okay, our collection segment is FSCM. I will give the same code. Okay, and similar to the credit segment, when we created the credit segment, we assigned the credit segment to our company code. Same way, this collection segment, for which company codes are you going to use this collection segment, that you have to define or you have to assign here. So this collection segment will be used for which different company codes, you can define it here. Okay, so in our case, we are keeping it simple, which is FSCM company code is assigned to collection segment FSCM. Okay, and also you can see, you can assign the credit segments also to the collection segments. Why this is required now? Why do we need to assign the credit segment to the collection segment? Let's take an example. While defining what data should go from FI to collections, you also want to consider what is the total credit utilization. Okay, you can tell the system that send the information from FI to collections only for those customers whose credit utilization is more than 80%. So what you are doing, you are not only checking the values in FI, you are not only checking the document value, you are not only checking the overdue date value, you are also checking some of the values from the credit management component. So if you want to send the values of credit management component from here to collections, then definitely in addition to assigning the company code, you also need to assign the credit segments, right? So in our case, we will assign the credit segment also to collection segment. Okay, and try to save it. Is my voice clear? I think system is little bit slow. Are you able to hear me clearly?
It's clear.
It's very much clear. Yeah.
Okay.
Vikram, I missed out here. That's the collection segment. You are saying that we need to assign the credit segment as well.
Yeah. Sorry. Go ahead.
Sorry, I was asking that in collection segment we having a possibility to assign credit segment as well. And you did explain something in one or two line. I completely missed out. What was the explanation?
Okay, no problem. See, you also want to transfer some data from credit management to collections management. I'll give you the example. So let's say you are creating the work list. Okay, you are trying to create a work list.
Yeah.
Which items from FI will go to collection segment, right? Which items from FI will go to collections management. So let's say there are total 5 overdue items, or let's say there are 5 customers whose items are overdue. Now, in addition to the checks that you performed in FI, you also want to tell the system, transfer the values to the collections management only for those customers whose credit utilization is more than 80%, right? So in this case, what will happen? Where the system will go and check the credit utilization? Credit utilization is at the credit segment level.
Right.
Right. That is the reason we need to assign the credit segment to the collection segment. So whenever system will try to see whether how much utilization of credit has been done for this particular customer, it will go to the credit segment level, which is assigned to your collection segment.
But it is nothing to do with the collection of pending invoices. Yeah, we will go through the example later on, but it looks a bit unpractical to me.
Let me show you one thing. See, if you remember, I told you there is a collection strategy. In the collection strategy, you tell the system which invoices to be considered and which invoices to be sent to the
collection department
management. Yeah. Collection department, right? So what are the different options there? What, based on what information you can say whether this invoice should go or not? So there are some collection rules, although I'll explain you in this detail after the completion of this session. This will be very clear, but yes, till the time you see one's end-to-end scenario, it will be difficult to digest these things. But let me show you one thing. See, these are the different rules based on which you can decide whether the document to be sent to the collections department or not. And in these rules, in these conditions, there is one or two conditions which are related to credit management. See, credit limit utilization, right? You will be able to see some more if you want to add. So based on the credit management component also, if you want to decide whether this document should be sent to the collection department or not, in that case, the values needs to flow from the credit segment, not from the FI, right? And that is the reason the values which are flowing from FI are coming through the assigned company codes, while the values which are flowing from credit segment, they are related to the credit utilization, based on which system will determine whether this document should be sent to the collection department or not.
I got your point, but the thing is that does the combination of few rules work on one customer, or it's just one to one?
No. One customer can have both. One customer, yes, can have both. Let me give you the practical example. Now, I am a company and there are some 10 customers. okay, who are having the overdue items. Now in FI, I have the condition that if this overdue items are overdue from more than 7 days, then I want to send to the collection department. But in addition to that, there is another condition that I will only send the collections, I will only send the documents to the collection department if the credit utilization of customer is more than 80%. So in that case, what will happen? Out of the 10 customers, it may happen that the collection department is only getting the documents of 8 customers because remaining 2 customers have failed the check related to the credit utilization.
Yeah, got it. It's a combination of rule that applies before invoices goes to the collection department. It's not one rule. Okay, that makes sense.
The strategy is a combination, right? In our case, I created a simple strategy in which there was only one rule. But if you see within one strategy, you can have multiple rules, multiple conditions based on which system will determine whether to send the document to the collection department or not. And in these conditions, some values will flow from company code like FI data, and some values can flow from the credit data also. That is the reason we are assigning both company code as well as credit segment.
Yeah, that's fine. If it's the combination of rule, then it makes sense.
Yes.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay. Let's go back. Sure. Okay, and then yeah, let's create a credit segment. I think we already created. Yes, we created the credit, sorry, collection segment, and within collection segment, we assigned it to company codes. Yes, and we also assigned to the credit segment. It's again go to the collection segment. There is one tick. Yeah. So you will not be able to use this collection segment if the status is not released. Right. So once you complete all your activities, once you complete the setting up of the collection segment, if you want to use it in your scenario, then definitely it has to be released. After the release, you will not be able to delete any credit segment and company code. Okay, just to make the consistency, it is not very easy to delete the company codes or credit segments. It will create the inconsistency in the system. So it is not recommended once you released it, whatever company codes and whatever credit segments are already assigned, you cannot delete it. You can always add it. So let's say tomorrow you created a new company code and you want to add it into the same collection segment. Adding is possible. But deletion, if the data is already posted, it will create inconsistencies and it is not recommended. So before you release it, just make sure that whatever settings you have done are correct. Okay, so I'm releasing because in our case, there is only one company code and one credit segment.
I have a question.
Yeah.
What kind of inconsistencies will be in case you delete the segment?
Okay, see, based on the settings, what you are defining here, based on the settings, maybe you can read this also. It was the same thing. It cannot be changed. Okay, let's see. We'll do that. Mm-hmm. So what you are doing is based on the configuration that you are doing here, you are telling the collections department what documents will flow from your FI data and what documents will flow from your credit management data. Right now, let's say you have done a lot of transactions, and after the transactions, now you came here and you said, no, this company code is not required. I want to change this assignment. So what will happen to the previous documents which are already created in the tables? There are a lot of documents which are already posted from this company code to this collection segment. So that is the inconsistency that I'm talking about. So system normally doesn't allow, once this is released, it will not allow you to come here and you can delete from here. Let's try. It will give you the error. Okay. So if you go to company codes and if you try to delete this, okay, it is not giving any error as of now. Let's try to save it. Okay. Okay, it is allowing you to save as of now because there is no document posted, I think. Otherwise, right. If you just try to see this documentation, okay, so it will tell you the same thing. You can only assign a collection segment to if the collection segment has been released.
All right.
Okay. If the collection segment that has been released, you no longer delete the company codes. So although it is allowing us now, I think the basic reason is there is no document posted as of now. That is the reason. Otherwise, you can see this clear condition. deletion of company codes after the release is normally not recommended, not possible.
So if I want to, if I assigned a company code to a collection segment, and then down the line we decide that we want to have it on a different collection segment. So if we cannot delete from here, then how to, I'm not sure if my question is coming out correctly.
No, exactly.
I have a company code assigned here, and after a few months, few years, we decide that we want to have it on a different segment, and we are not able to delete here. If we delete, we will have inconsistencies. Then how do we go about that to make sure we don't have
inconsistencies? Let me ask you one reverse question, then you will understand. So let's take a same example in credit management.
Yeah.
Okay, you assigned the different company codes to the credit management, and now you decided, no, I want to assign my company code to another credit management. Is it possible? Or let's take example of controlling area. You assigned one company code to, or multiple company codes to one controlling area, and after posting the documents, now you want to change the controlling area. Is it possible?
No.
Exactly. So it is a project in itself. If you want to change this assignment, then definitely it involves a lot of like, you definitely will not be able to do as per the standard project, right? It has to be treated as a separate project. Maybe you need some tools from SAP which will help you in doing this reorganization. But that is the reason it is very important before you decide on how many collection segments you are going to use. Which company codes are you going to assign to the collection segment, similarly to the credit segment, similar to the controlling area? All this design has to be in place based on which you will be configuring. And once you done some postings, then definitely after that, it is no longer possible to come here and delete it.
Okay.
Make sense? You can always add. See, similarly, if I create a new company code and I want to add that new company code to my controlling area, I can do it, no problem.
Yeah,
if I create
fine.
A new company code, yeah, I want to add to the new credit segment, that is also possible. Similarly, once you post something, it is no longer possible to delete the company codes from your collection segment.
Okay.
Vikram, I have a question.
Yes.
Vikram, you are mentioning about the collection segment here, defining and assigning. Can one credit collection segment can be assigned to multiple credit segments? Like, for example, you had given an example of a collection segment.
Yes, one collection segment, you can assign multiple credit segments, you can assign multiple company codes.
Okay.
And you can keep on adding also.
It's all depends upon our definition.
Yes, exactly. So the top node is collection segment. Within one collection segment, there can be multiple company codes. There can be multiple credit segments.
Okay. Right. And also, suppose if we have to, if the limit is not exceeded, but number of days overdue is exceeded, then what will be the rule?
No, there are different rules. So the rule that I have shown you is a combination of both. Right, but there are multiple rules. If you come to this collection rules, there is a single rule also where it will only check the number of days. Okay, so let me show you if there is anything related to just the number of days. It is not created as a collection rule. Let's go to the basic rule. I'll tell you what is the difference between basic rule and collection rule. Okay, so there are a lot of different things. There are a lot of different rules which are pre-delivered by SAP. Based on your requirement, you can use whatever you want. Okay, and even maybe the thing that you asked, you don't want to keep it on the amount, like you want to keep it open. So that is the reason I provided 0 to 99999. So I'm not worried about the amount. I'm only worried about the days.
That's also one scenario. Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
So there are a lot of rules actually. We will talk about these rules shortly, but let me just try to go further. And if we try to create a scenario, then everything will become clear. But before that, we definitely need to do some basic configuration. Yeah.
Hi, Vikram. You are saying documents are not posted. So So you mean after defining this collection management, no document posture, because already there are many open items in FFIPN.
So no, in our collection segment, we just created the collection segment, right? I'm talking about our collection segment. Have we transferred any documents from FI to collection segment? Our definition itself is not until now. We are still not activated the collections management in our company code. So what I mean is, once you transfer the data from your FI component to collection management component, then only this will have some value. If there are some values here, then it is not recommended to delete the company codes.
So it means
as of now, we have not posted anything to this collection.
Okay, so I would say one data has been transferred from FI to FSCM, right? Posted, because already in this company code data has already posted, right? So this means that
Right. What I am talking about is data is not posted in collections. You are right. So it is not about company code. I'm talking about data is not posted till now in this particular collection segment.
Vikram, if we say transfer the data, that will make more sense, because posting. That is transfer.
So
because the overdue
say that data is not
transferred,
or maybe not transferred, not posted. There is no data. Let's talk about there is no data in the collection segment as of now.
Because I was thinking already we have posted so many document. Now which document we are talking about posting?
It is not about company code, it is about collection segment. So I hope you got the point now. It is all about data. Do you have some data in the collection segment? So as of now, there is no data in collection segment. That is the reason it is allowing. I have not tried this, but even after creating the data, even after transferring the data, if it is allowing but it is not recommended to come here and delete that particular company code. Okay, so I'll just create it once again. I will go with FSCM and then let's try to save it. Okay, let's go back. Okay, so this was collection segment. Now let's go to the collection profile. Okay, so again I will quickly create a collection profile. In our case, the collection profile is FSCM. Okay, and within this FSCM, I have to assign the collection segment. New entry, our collection segment is FSCM. Okay, you can see here. When I'm creating the customer, or whenever I'm extending this collection management to the customer, I am just entering the collection profile. So based on this collection profile, collection segment is automatically getting determined, because in the current activity that I am doing, I am assigning collection profile to the collection segment, right? So in the customer master data, I will just enter this collection profile. System will automatically determine this collection segment. Okay, so save it. And then let's go to the next one. The last one is a collection group. So as I told you, collection group is a group of collection specialist. Now, what is collection specialist? Collection specialists are nothing but the employees who are working in the collections department. So each and every employee is a collection specialist. And if I group those collection specialist into different groups, I give you the example, like one group will only take care of the international customers, second group will only take care of the domestic customers. So this is nothing but the collection groups in which there will be multiple employees who are working. So I will create a new collection group, let's say again with FSCM. Okay, and this one I will assign to the strategy. As of now, I have not created the strategy for FSCM. So maybe before we do this, it's also fine to create a collection strategy for us. Otherwise, we may get confused. Okay, so collection strategy is where you will tell the system what are the conditions to transfer the values from finance and credit segment to collection segment, which you can define here in process strategies. Okay, so I'm creating a new strategy. This new strategy name again I'm giving as FSCM. Okay, which currency? So let's take an example. There are three company codes: company code A, company code B, company code C. Company code A is from India, company code B is from Singapore, and company code C is from USD. Now, whenever I am telling the system that the value should be more than a particular amount, so I have to tell the system in the currency which I specified here. So even if for Indian company code, I cannot say if the amount is more than 1000 INR. I have to tell the system the amount is more than how much USD. Right? So this is a currency which is for my collection segment, for collection, for collection strategy. Similar to credit segment. If you remember, when we created the credit segment, we provided the currency. Same way for collection strategy also, we have to provide the currency at which we are going to set up the conditions. So I'll keep this as USD.
So yeah. This currency would be irrespective of your group currency and global currency.
Yes. Okay. Exactly. It can be any currency in which you want to process your collections.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But what should be the ideal situation?
There is no ideal situation, right? Because it totally depends upon customer to customer. So normally, see, nobody would like to create a currency which is not your company code currency, controlling area currency, and group currency. Ultimately, if you are having multiple companies, then definitely your collections will be also managed at the group level. So if there are multiple currencies in your setup, then definitely this should have been group currency. At what level you are going to maintain all your company codes within this collection strategy. But again, it is independent. So if I provide anything else, it will not give me the error that your group currency is different. It is irrespective of what currencies you are using, but most probably the customers will be using the group currency here only.
Okay.
I will talk about this. I'll talk about other things also. I'm just going through the mandatory things as of now. So this is where you will be assigning the rules. Okay, this is where you are going to tell the system which documents will flow from FI to FSCM. So if I simply come here and create, see, these are the different rules I can mention. Okay, I'm going with this rule: total of all open item overdue since n number of days. So I'll take the same example that we discussed just now. Forget about this valuation as of now. I'll talk about this. So open this or select this and go to prerequisite and conditions. So amount wise, I'm going with 0 to 999, which means there is no limit. It can be anything if it is overdue by 7 days. So what I'm doing is simple. Any document which is overdue by more than 7 days, I want to transfer from FI to my collection segment. Simple. Right, so this is a very simple strategy. You can make it whatever conditions you want to enter here, and you can make it how much complex you want to make it based on the customer's requirement. All right, so this is our new strategy that we created. This strategy I will assign to
the maximum value is going zero.
Ideally it should be 100, right?
Kalika, your voice is not clear. Can you come again?
When you are defining the collection strategy, there is option maximum value. So it should be the total of 100. So it is showing zero. Could you please go to again collection strategy?
Yeah. That we have still not discussed. I'll talk about that also.
Okay.
Yeah. That is related to the priority. So no need to worry as of now. Maybe if you want, I can just give this as 10. Okay, you are talking about this one, right? Maximum valuation.
Right.
Yeah, we will talk about this. As of now, let's skip this. You can see now it is changed to whatever value you entered here. Okay. Now let's go back and go to collection groups. Now these are our collection groups. So I will create a new group. Again, I'm giving the same name, FSCM, or maybe if you want to try 2-3 groups, you can add